And now it is my pleasure to introduce someone with an incredible personality, Adman Suhail Seth. Suhail Seth is the managing partner of consultancy firm Consulage India, founded by him in June 2002. He has previously worked at advertising agencies Response, Ogilvy & Mather, and Equus, which he co-founded with his younger brother Swapan. He has also co-founded the marketing consultancy firm Quadra Advisory. Mr. Seth is also an author, columnist, actor, TV pundit, and socialite. Mr. Suhail Seth. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the man of the moment. An amazing musician and an incredible person. And the author, of course, of Master on Masters. Ustad Amjad Ali Khan. He is one of the undisputed masters of the music world, who gave his first performance at the age of 6 and is credited with reinventing the technique of playing the sarod. Over the course of a distinguished career spanning more than 6 decades, he has won numerous accolades, including a Grammy nomination, the Crystal Award by the World Economic Forum, the Sangeet Natak Academy Award, and all 3 Padma Awards. He has performed at venues the world over. Please welcome Ustad Amjad Ali Khan. Before we release the book, I'd like to introduce, I don't know if people have introduced you as this before, the wind beneath Ustad Ji's wings. Could I please invite on stage his very beautiful wife, Srimati Subbalakshmi Khan. Miss Mili Aishwarya, can you join us back on stage again? And it's now time for me to ask Karan to please release the book. Can we have the book, please? Read an excerpt from the book, and after that, Suhail, I'd like to request you to moderate the rest of the evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Sujitra. Thank you very much. Thank you for being as gracious as you always are. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to begin by saying what a tremendous honor it is for me to be on this platform with Khan Saab, truly a living legend and someone who not only inspires us, but is the pride of our country in every which way. Thank you, sir. Thank you for inviting me and allowing me to do the honors this evening. Good evening, Suhail. It's always a pleasure to be with you on a platform.
Lovely. Thank you. Likewise.
Thank you. More about that later.
Platform or likewise?
Both.
Lovely.
Likewise, you are a platform.
Look forward.
It is truly my honor to read an excerpt from the book, which I'm going to do just now. That's why I choose not to sit, because everyone in this book is such a legend that to give them the required respect is truly the need of the moment, the hour, and of course. The chapter I will read is on Begum Akhtar. It was a personal experience that Khan Saab has shared with us in the book, and I'd like to read an excerpt from there. Begum Sahiba had great regard and admiration for my father. She once told me that she tried to persuade Abba Sahab to record his music. But he was against recordings because he had observed classical music records being played during weddings and private parties while the guests milled about talking, eating, and drinking. Whatever recordings of his are available are from his live radio broadcasts late in his life. None exist of him playing at his prime. Begum Sahiba tried to convince him on many, many occasions, but he stood his ground. The first time I saw Begum Sahiba perform was in Calcutta. She always smiled while she sang. Before I could say adab to her, she promptly said, "Khan Sahab, adab." I thought she was making fun of me. Whenever I was in the audience, she would make it a point to seek my permission before she sang in the concert, saying, "Khan Sahab, ijazat hai. Khan Sahab, may I begin?" I used to feel quite embarrassed by this until I realized that through me, she was honoring and paying her respects to my forefathers. She maintained this warmth and love from the stage on every occasion. Sometime in 1970 or 71, a few years before she passed away, AIR in Kashmir invited both of us to perform at Hari Bhavan. We stayed at the beautiful Oberoi Hotel, now Hotel Lalit. Governor Bhagwan Sahai was the chief guest. It was a packed hall. Being much younger than her, I requested Begum Sahiba to allow me to begin the evening. On hearing this, she touched both her ears and said, "Ye gustakhi, main nahi kar sakti. I cannot do this." I was really worried about performing after her, but she was adamant. Our exchange went on for some time. When the AIR officials came to invite us, I tried to rush to the stage. But Begum Sahiba caught my hand and ran onto the stage herself, and I was left behind in the wings, watching her. When the curtain was opened, she sat down and began her concert with a smile. Shakur Khan and Ramzan Khan were on the sarangi and tabla, respectively. Backstage, I was listening to her ethereal songs and praying to God Almighty to bless my concert too. She sang four ghazals, and every song was so appealing that it left the audience enthralled. During the intermission, before my performance, Governor Sahai came backstage to meet the artists. When it was my turn to perform, to my utter surprise, I saw Begum Sahiba sitting in the audience. To give respect and to honor her gracious and magnanimous gesture, I kept my sarod aside and said that after her singing, I had forgotten all ragas and raginis. I requested her to return to her hotel and rest. She said, "Lijiye, ke hum aapko sun nahi sakte, bismillah kariye aap. Can I not listen to you? Please begin." This was one of my most cherished memories of Begum. This truly seems like a special book, a book for all music lovers, a book for everyone searching for soul, and a book that doesn't only travel and transcend, but also connects so deeply. Thank you again for giving me this opportunity. You should consider being invited.
Who does that show? That Johar lad, right?
Yeah, okay. Someone there. The nepotistic man.
Okay, we'll come to that later. But I'm so delighted to be here. I've had the privilege and the fortune of knowing Gusrat Sahab and the family for now almost 20 years. That's a long time. That's about the time that the Congress will take to return to power. And I'm delighted to welcome Milind Deora here. But that for later. But I think what Karan read out today, the passage on Begum Akhtar, reflects a generation that is slowly slipping from our times. A generation where respect was not only stated, it was felt. Where there was a tehzeeb, there was a fitra, but most importantly, there was the appreciation of sharing the other person's greatness. And I think, Usaji, to your credit, for me personally, this isn't a book. It's a lesson in life. It's very rare that people appreciate others who are greater than themselves. David Ogilvy famously said, if you want to become a company of giants, hire people better than yourself. If you want to become a company of dwarfs, hire people who are inferior. The fact that a master has written on masters, to my mind, has opened vistas for young people and old into the lives that no longer walk the planet. So for that, thank you. And let me begin by asking you the general ubiquitous question. Why these 12 and why not the others?
Before I answer the question, I would like to thank Mr. Karan Johar and Mr. Sohail Seth to be part of this celebration and launching of the book. I would like to address them because in our music world, anybody who achieves something, we call them star and pandit. I think Pandit Karan Johar and Pandit Sohail Seth. Because I admire Mr. Karan Johar. I have seen films, I have seen his Coffee with Karan. And he's very gifted and he's a pure artist. And same with Mr. Sohail Seth. God has given him that creativity and he has so much energy on any subject he can talk. And I really admire both of them. Generally in our field, a disciple only rides on his guru and on his father. And because if he rides on somebody else, maybe his father and guru will not appreciate that. So that has been the tradition of Indian classical music. And that is why there's hardly any books available to read on great masters. But my guru, my father, Ustad Hafiz Ali Khan Sahab, he often said that you must look for the quality in other musicians also. And I'm very fortunate that I could see the magic of these great masters. I still remember going to Jalandhar. There used to be a big festival of classical music, Harbhajan Festival. Still continues, but not the same way. This was 1964. I was invited. And all these giants, they were there, all these great masters. And so I can't forget them. They were the stars, and because of them, this classical music became famous and popular, not only in India, but all over the world. People respect our art and culture and music. It was a big list of musicians, but these 12 musicians, because of my personal equation, they were the trendsetters. Today, somebody is following Pandit Ravi Shankar sitar, or somebody is following Ustad Vinayat Khan sitar. So they were the trendsetters. They established style of sitar. And it was a great honor and pleasure that I could think back and could collect my thoughts, because I never practice for language. My world is sound, because through sound I cannot manipulate anything. It's very transparent. But language is difficult for me to understand. But I'm so glad to hear such language of Mr. Sohail Seth and Karan Johar. I really admire both of them.
Thank you. Karan, it's a very interesting insight that Ustad Ji just gave. And in many ways, the film industry, I hate to use the word Bollywood, the film industry in Bombay, the Hindi film industry, also has a lot of respect and tehzeeb for the seniors. Do you think times are changing? Do you think the respect quotient in many ways is diminishing because there's more proximity, there's more closeness? Where do you see the film industry from where you look at it?
Well, I think that, you know, I have come from a generation that explained and I would say made me, you know, respect people in a certain manner. So I think it's the way you show respect has definitely evolved and changed, because the younger generation just show it very differently through their words and through their, you know, actions. Whereas when I was a child, I remember my father taking me to a film party and he said, if I say this is my son, shake his hand. If I say ye mera beta hai, you touch their feet. So I was just waiting for that cue right through. I was like almost on autopilot.
And what if there was a South Indian?
I don't know, I didn't get so technical then. But But I do remember that that was the way that, you know, you honored your, when I met Lata Ji or I met Mr. Bachchan. It was just the way we showed our respect. The generation today does respect the seniors in the fraternity for sure. It's just a different way of showing it. I'm not sure. I get a bit shocked at times when I feel like the generation that is young and new, and they meet some legends very casually. They shake their hands. They have respect in their heart. It's just that we, I think, have been trained and tuned to kind of meet them in a certain way, which has definitely changed. But I think that, you know, with time, I'm quite amazed with the way the generation operates. Because I think that, you know, it takes a certain ease to not be overtly reverential and respectful. And that's not in my DNA, but it's in theirs. And I think with time, I think, and with the excessive use of social media and just, I think everyone's about themselves and not about others. And we come from a generation that learns to applaud everybody else's work and not just fester within ourselves. And I think that has definitely changed.
So that's a very interesting takeoff point. Ustaji says that a world existed where you applauded the other person, you applauded someone else's craft. You, in many ways, through this book, have done exactly that. You've not only applauded their craft, you've applauded their life, you've applauded their beliefs, their quirks, whatever it may be. Do you believe that in today's world of classical music, in our country, things are changing? And are they changing for the better or for the worse, or they're just changing because people are evolving? As Karan says, media's never been more intrusive. Media's never been more personal. Today I can get to know your political idiom, your religious belief, your food habits because of what you tweet or what you put on Instagram. So do you believe you're seeing that change even in the world of classical music?
I think from the time television came in our life in India, the traditional arts, they suffered. But gradually, I think every genre, there is a big audience. Even for classical music, there are fusion concerts. So the change is very healthy, I think. But it all depends on the kind of musicians you have in our country or in the world. It all depends if the music is appealing. People will listen to you, whether you are a European musician or whether you are an Indian musician. But things are changing. There was a time in Calcutta, there used to be 25 music festivals in every year. A lot of musicians used to live in Calcutta for 2-3 months to attend all the festivals. So that has changed. Now only Dover Lane left, yeah, in Calcutta, Maharashtra, South. So, but fortunately, even today, there are sold out shows for classical music, for ghazal, for bhajan, for any kind of music. So, change is a very natural factor, and I think we are all ready to face any kind of change.
You know, Karan, I was born and raised in Calcutta, and I remember spending hours, evening after evening, literally at the feet of Satyajit Ray, who would play the piano every evening at 4:30 p.m. Lee Road. That time I was rehearsing for a play called Amadeus. There was a genuine desire to learn. The Adda was at the heart of our lives because it was all about conversation. It was a city which never judged you. It had no prejudices. Sometimes do you believe that with the changing norms, with more urbanization, with more migration, do you think that has kind of altered? Where people can actually have a long conversation discussing Louis Mall or discussing Brando, discussing Kurosawa. Do you think that has literally slipped out of our lives?
I think technology is largely to blame, and it has. You know, you find those conversations very rare that are actually about art and about like artists, and you know, where you can actually stay away from your phone, which has become like a part of your body now. I think it's almost attached like an organ, and you know, there's nothing you can do about it. And I think that we're always so distracted for various reasons. You know, I see people not talking to each other at all anymore. Like, you just have visuals of people just sitting across dining tables and even in their homes and just engaged on their mobile telephone. And I think that it's just taken away, just like I think technology has killed romance in general. I think it's also killed conversation. And I think I seek. I'm a rare breed. I'm probably a dinosaur that still wants to talk to people about other things than, you know, their day-to-day obstacles or issues or personal lives or infidelities or whatever. There are so many other things up in the world that you'd like to engage with them on, which I think has drastically reduced, and I'm sure you know that. And I think some of us who came from a generation where we did see this, enjoy it. I've been around filmmakers. I've had the pleasure and privilege to actually see Raj Kapoor on set, watch Yash Chopra direct a film, be in a music session with Lakshmikant Pyarelal, and, you know, actually had the pleasure of a conversation, even though I was very tiny, with R.D. Burman. And I remember that that generation spoke, engaged, shared their work, their experience, their craft. It doesn't happen anymore, not in my fraternity at all. It's all very individual. It's almost artistically selfish, and I think that has never served the purpose of art in a large way. So unfortunately, Sohil, to answer your question, no, I think that whether it's migration or it's technology or it's just a huge sense of self-worth that I think has translated into the lack of, I would say, conversation or sharing, which is what I think you're talking about.
I'll pick up, and Ustaji, I'll get Karan also to respond to this. At the heart of your belief system, and I know this, is your family. I know the same about Karan. I'm exactly the same. I'm very proud to say that I live with my mother. I see your children, I see your grandchildren, I see your daughter-in-law, interwoven into a family that has deep beliefs and has inherent respect. That respect knows no age, it knows no craft, it knows no purpose. Do you believe we're missing some of that? And is that kind of creating an influence, either negative or positive, over the way music is being created? You know, the gharana was at the heart of legacy building, but is also at the heart of continuity. Has that kind of changed today?
I would like to share one incident of Ustad Amir Khan Sahab. He was called musician's musician. He sang for himself. He never tried to find out what the audience needs, what they want. Once there was a concert at LG of Delhi, the first LG, Mr. A.N. Jha. So A.N. Jha has invited all the governors of India, and it was a very official dinner there. So Mr. Jha spoke to me, he called me personally. He says, you have to perform, and Ustad Amir Khan Sahab will sing also. So he sent his car, a huge big car, Impala, and we all sat in that car, and we were just going towards LG's house. And Khan Sahab, raste mein mujhe, keh rahe bhai, ye governor aa rahe hain, ko music ki samajh to hai nahi, tum bhi kam bajana, main bhi kam gaunga. To maine kaha, huzoor, main to aapko sunne ja raha hoon, main aapke saamne kya bajaunga. Anyway, finally we reached there, and I finished my concert within half an hour. And there were about 5-6 of us to say, Baba, bahut achhe, kya baat hai. And it was a spotlight on all of us, and Khan Sahab started singing one rag. Great performance, and we were saying, Baba, Baba, Baba. And it was his style that while singing one rag, he'll suddenly start the second rag. He started second rag. He lost track of time. And the governor is in sign language asking me when he's going to finish. So I say, I don't know, but please take your guest for dinner. I can't stop him. So he kept on singing and singing, and now only Mr. Jha was alone sitting in the audience. All the governors, they went inside. And Khan Sahab was in a great mood. We were saying, wah, 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 bahut achhe, kya baat. He started third rag also. And poor Jha is again asking me what to do. I say, you also go. So Mr. Jha also left, nobody in the audience, Khan Sahab still singing. And then suddenly, I think somewhere he realized that there's nobody in the audience. And then abruptly he stopped and he just said, kale yaar zyada ho gaya, aaj mujhe abhi bada, kale zyada ho gaya. Mujhe Khan Sahab bahut maza aa raha tha, bahut acha. So you see, most of the classical musicians, they disconnected themselves with the audience. They didn't realize what they want. There was another great singer of his time, Ustad Bedu Ghulam Ali Khan sir. He knew the pulse of, but he never sang too long. He will just finish at the right moment. And both these great singers, they sang for the films also. Ustad Amir Khan sahab sang your Janak Janak Pahil Baje, the title song. And Bade Ghulam Ali Khan sahab in Mughal-e Azam, he sang. Even Pandit Bhimsen Joshi sang in the film. So some musicians were recognized more, some they were not so much known. But most of them dedicated their life to understand what is music, what is lay. And my old forefathers and all of us, we were not allowed to plan our life. Just practice, you surrender yourself to God, surrender yourself to Guru. Don't think about tomorrow. And that was the lifestyle of classical musicians. So everybody practiced. Somebody was successful, somebody was not successful. But they continued the classical music. And it's almost like entering into a dark tunnel with the hope of sun rays someday. But it's a great pleasure to understand day by day the depth of music, what is music. In our country we say, Swar hi Ishwar hai. The music connects you to God. And whether it's a film song or European song or folk song or any song, it's all based on these seven notes, Sare Gama Padani and Pasulati. But the beauty of our music is not only improvisation. People always talk Indian music means improvisation. But the salient features are the slides and glides. Slides and glides, I often feel that it's the influence of our Indian culture. The humility, the namaskar or shashtang namaskar, and you were talking about touching the feet. So all this humility, the grace what we have, that has influenced our Indian classical music. And fortunately, the future is bright because there are so many. In the generation of Aman and Ayan, there are so many talented young musicians. And so I feel very happy and proud to see them progressing. They are established classical musicians.
About the family being at the heart of it?
Well, it is, in a sense, your strength. I mean, you know, though I think that so much is talked about in recent times about, you know, like, you know, this whole family structure, etc., that is an organic part of it's whether it's dissed, it's criticized or discussed, it's a reality. It's the way it is. I think in my case, you know, it was my father was a producer and therefore I was introduced to the world of the Indian movies. But I think that the strength that you get from your family is much more than just the creative force that comes with it. It's also because we're in a creative field and somehow that lends itself to deep levels of insecurity. And I think you just need the power of family to keep you grounded. At my end, it was my father who taught me some ropes and my mother who makes sure that I'm grounded on a daily level and pretends like every time I'm awarded or honored, she always wants to know why. And it's actually very heartening to have a mother who's not your fan.
She isn't the only one asking the question.
Yeah, I'm sure she isn't. But she's definitely the first one asking the question. And sometimes it's a bit deflating before, you know, you're going somewhere to actually have your... But then I realized later that she's doing it very much, you know, to kind of make sure that at no point I let anything get to me. So family suits that purpose within... And I think, Sohail, more so, I think, in a creative world, I think you need that strength. Because, as I said, you're far more vulnerable, you're far more insecure, and you're always, I think, seeking either acceptance or you're kind of fighting delusion. And for both situations, you need someone strong to tell you at home.
Sansa, I want to touch upon, and, you know, this will be the last two or three questions, then we'll open it out for a Q&A. I want to touch upon something that, you know, in Calcutta we were very fastidious about, which is the purity of the craft, the essentials of theatre. Like, we wouldn't regard musicals as theatre, I still don't. We believe that rehearsals were when you were completely ready with the script, with the lines, and then you began the first rehearsal. There was a joy in being pure to the craft. Obviously, times have changed. Karan rightly alluded to the fact that technology is actually shrinking time and matching man's current impatience. Do you believe we lack that purity? And is that a good thing or a bad thing?
I don't think it's a good thing. The purity is most important. And you see, technology and tradition, they have to be friends. I feel proud to see a human being has created keyboard. A keyboard can produce the sound of violin and flute and sitar and everything. And many musicians have lost job because of keyboard. And thank God the keyboard can't produce sarod till now.
Don't give them an idea.
So I'm waiting to hear sarod from the keyboard. But you feel proud to see the cell phone and the fax machine and keyboard, the achievements of human being. But in our musical science, our 12 notes were realized even 5,000 years before. 5,000 years back. And today, in this time, nobody could create the 13th musical note. Everything, the whole world is connected with these 12 notes. Music has connected the whole world. And we are almost like one close-knit family, whether you sing Lok Sangeet or Film Sangeet or Ghazal, Bhajan, Kirtan, anything. The same sound. In 13th century, the Sufi saint, Hazrat Amir Khusro, who created Qawwali called Kalbana, he created a style of singing called Tarana. Tarana does not deal with language. Every song has a language, whether Ghazal, Thumri, Dadra, Lok Sangeet, everything. He created a language of sound. He created language of syllables, Tana Tom, Tadare, Dirdirdani. So as a tribute to Hazrat Amir Khusro, I've been composing many taranas. Tadare Dani, Tadare Dani, Tadani Dim, Tana Tano, Tadare Dani, Tadani Dim, Tana Tano, Tanum, Tananum, Tadirena, Tadirena, Tadirena. Taderena, taderena, tadare dani, tadani dim, tana tano, tana na 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 dim, tana na 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 na, tana na 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 dim, tana na 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 na, tana nom, tana nom, taderena, tana nom, tadare dani, dakita dakita dum, dakita 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 tadare dani, tadani dim, tana tano.
This is my penultimate question to Karan, and then one last one to you. You know, there was a very interesting play written by Peter Schaeffer called Amadeus, in which Salieri, who's the court musician, says of himself that I'm the patron saint of mediocrity. And Mozart was this prodigious genius who came and defied all the rules. You, in many ways, have defied the traditional rules of cinema. When you take these risks, and the risks are both financial and
No, no, I understood. Namaskar, sir. So, sorry, I'm not supposed to be answering this. But Ustad or Walid sahab baithe, I shouldn't be speaking out of turn. But I think the future is bright. There's so many young musicians today who are doing so well. And I think this generation is very blessed to get so much content easily available now on YouTube and so many other platforms. So they've got the research of all the great masters very easily available. They all are playing brilliantly, but now who connects and who doesn't, I think Khuda ke haath mein, Bhagwan ke haath mein. So that I really can't comment on, but I think the quality of musicians, even today, like I said, because they're getting so much access to the journey of these great masters, I think they have all the imbibe these qualities and they are playing brilliantly. And even today, so many, every time you open Bombay Times, how many ads you see of so many young musicians performing in Bombay, in Bengal, Maharashtra, all over. So I don't think there's anything to worry about. In time, I'm sure these young musicians will also connect with people. And I think the next question was for...
Sorry, please. No, there's a lady there. And let that be. That's it. Do you really have to ask? Bless each one of you, and God bless America.
Thank you, Sohail Seth. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, Ustad Amjad Ali Khan, Master on Masters. On behalf of Penguin Random House India, I'd like to extend a big thank you to all of you for being here and being part of this evening.
So, should I talk in English or Hindi? Yes, I'm okay. You see, it took nearly 2-3 years. Suddenly, there is a vacuum. So many great musicians just passed away. And we used to perform in the same festival. Vilayat Khan Sahib, Ravi Shankar Ji, Bhimsen Joshi Ji, Kumar Gandhar Ji. And suddenly they have all passed away. So I miss them. I feel vacuum now. I have seen their magic. They gave their best. They became trend setters. People, sitar, anybody playing sitar, they will follow Ravi Shankar or Vilayat Khan. And they were trend setters, and they were they made classical music popular all over the world. So it was a very big list, but 12 musicians, because I'm not a great writer, but it needs a lot of homework. So I chose 12 people only, and I very closely observed their contributions, their magic, and what they have given to the world. And I'm grateful to Penguin Random House for trusting me and for handling such sensitive subject like classical music.
Which is difficult part in the book?
I have given some anecdotes also.
Okay.
Actually, most of them, all of us actually belong to different gharanas. Historically, a musician always wrote book on his guru or on his father. But I'm grateful to my guru, my father, Ustad Hafiz Ali Khan sir. He often told me that I must find out the good points in every musician. Sarod बहुत popular है. अभी Sarod has become very popular. There are about 500 Sarod players all over the world. बहुत Sarod बजा रहे हैं लोग. Sarod is a Persian word which means music. Nagma Tarannum. और अभी Aman और Ayan की generation में बहुत सारे Sarod player हैं. They are very talented. Not only Sarod players, sitar, gana, tabla, हर field में we have very talented musicians and the future is very bright.
You also get
हाँ देखिए अवार्ड्स तो बहुत मिले हैं लेकिन सबसे बड़ा मेरा जो बैंक बैलेंस है वो लोगों का प्यार है मोहब्बत है आशीर्वाद है माय बैंक बैलेंस इज पीपल्स लव ब्लेसिंग्स एंड एनकरेजमेंट हाँ जी जी हाँ जी तो लोगों का प्यार मिला है बायोपिक बन सकती है जब भी जो भी बनाना चाहेगा आई एम अवेलेबल फॉर देम ठीक है
व्हाट यू थिंक हु इज द सूटेबल कैरेक्टर इन दिस फॉर टू प्ले आउट
नहीं मैंने सुना नहीं अभी देश सोचा नहीं इसके बारे में और ये तो डायरेक्टर के ऊपर डिपेंड करेगा प्रोड्यूसर के ऊपर डिपेंड करेगा वो किसको चूज करेंगे और जब भी
मोर केपेबल to play your character and who is a favorite director in Bollywood?
ये सब सोचने वाली बातें हैं और सोच के जब वक्त आएगा तो जब आपको बताएंगे
धन्यवाद
आइए भैया